Hello, welcome back to Blender Sushi Live Noding. In this episode, I'm going to explore Blender timeline marker and kind of trying to explain this idea of like a queue within a timeline. And I was thinking, and then maybe I shouldn't use sequencer yet, but I can simply use the timeline in Blender and kind of observe all this marker. The nice thing about marker is that, of course, it's very, very simple. There's only one timeline, and you can easily move marker whenever you need it. And you can actually time a lot of things using marker, whether it's like an animation or color or size. Like in this case, I'll show you. I'll just run the timeline. Actually, if I have the Sonic Pi running, this setup will trigger a sound whenever there is a marker, and on top of that, it's also kind of controlling the visibility of this smaller monkey. And the bigger monkey actually changes scale, but it happens all in within one frame, so that's why you can't really see it. This is gonna be like explorations of Blender marker and using Sverchok add-on. So I'll start from scratch. And what I realized is, like, I always try to do everything in real time, which can be really cool if you can kind of like create a setup where dynamics happens and animation happens, and you can control sound based on animations, and everything happens in real time. That's gonna be like really powerful if that's possible. But if your computer is a bit slower and you can't do everything in real time, you can still do it right as long you kind of time, you kind of like cue and time things when it happens. So as long the timing is correct and the beat or the sound happens in the right time as the animation, then you can easily simulate the whole thing. You know, it's kind of like when you're shooting and then you're shooting with a green screen, and you just replace the green screen with other things, and then you change the actor with the CG actors if you like, and it's like iterative kind of work. So yeah, I found that Blender marker is one of the most interesting thing that you can do. You can sync the marker and the timeline while it's running in the background. So it's like, okay, first of all, I'll explain the marker first before I go too far. I'm gonna save this as marker exploration. And if you don't know what marker is something you can place in the timeline to mark something, and normally you can use it to switch the camera. So that's the basic. First of all, I'll set the camera like two camera for now. So we have these two camera, and marker is something that you can place in the timeline. You know, whatever you put this line here, you can just set a marker and add a marker by hitting M. So as long as you're hovering in the timeline, you can actually run the timeline and kind of make a marker. Just tap M wherever you feel like it. And then this is like something you can sync into sound or animations, and or even like lip syncing. So you put a marker where big things kind of happen, and by doing that, you know within the timeline where the important things happens, and you can really like add whatever on top of that. So marker is a good starting point to do like a timing, and you can easily shift it. Okay, so we have a bunch of markers already. I'll delete all of them again. I probably maybe I need something to sync into. I don't know if I should use sound yet. Maybe I won't be using sound yet. I'll just create a bunch of random marker. So there you go. I have five markers, and for each markers, I will try to bind it into a camera. Let's see. 5 marker. Anyway, with marker, first of all, you have position in time, and then you also can rename it if you like. Control M is to rename a marker. So if you are on top of a marker or you're selecting a marker, Control M, you can rename it to whatever. You can even like sync kind of like a subtitle even. Control M. So I just type in like hello and world. Supposedly you can really sync things. Yeah, hello world. And then the next thing we can do, if we have, I'll try actually make a 3 camera. Instead of a box, I will have a Susan head, so it's clearer. And let's create our view from the camera. Actually, this one is supposed to be properties, and this one, I want to turn it into a 3D view, and I want to look at active camera. So that's the active camera. Probably this guy with a black color triangle on top of it. With the markers, I know there's one function that you can use, and that's pretty useful. You can kind of bind a camera into a marker. So let's say for this marker, you want to bind it into camera. So the shortcut is Control B, and this currently active camera will be binded into the markers. So for the second one, for example, for this guy, I want to bind it into this camera. So Control B while we are hovering on the timeline. So now we can shift camera just based on the marker. So I can kind of shift this guy, and then I can change the camera that way. I think it's very, very cool. That's a kind of the things that I want to do using nodes actually. I want to be able to bind any kind of actions, and I want it to be triggered by the marker. That's basically the point of this live noding video. And maybe for this one, I want to use this camera. Just Control B while the marker is active. So we have like 3 camera being controlled by this marker, and then we can shift it any of this marker any way we like. So that's really cool, right? I think, so from this, so far we know that the marker can be set up. We can time it manually while the timeline is running. So I can, you know, tap M. Shit, we have a lot of markers already being created, and each marker actually have position in time, and we can rename it, and we can bind it to the camera. Now we want to be able to see all those kind of information, and we can use. You can choose animation nodes or Sverchok. I will use Sverchok actually, because Sverchok, I like Sverchok object ID, and you will see real quick. I'll quickly show you with so it's basically this BPY data, and all these nodes can access object and its properties. So I will use object ID selector to start with, and then I will pick scenes. Because this data of the markers actually belongs in the scene. I will quickly create a timeline up here. So I'll make it a bit bigger. So this is the timeline that we have currently. And this is our camera. So you can see the camera is changing because it's bound to the marker. Anyway, from the scenes, object scenes, we want to be able to see the marker. So how do we get there? Let me quickly check using Python console. Where's the Python console? There you go. So this is the way I kind of try to get to the data. We can actually have multiple scenes in Blender, but I'm not gonna go there yet. So bpy.data.scenes, name of the scene, okay. And we can save this as SC, and we can go deeper into the scene and we can find timeline markers. Okay, timeline markers. There you go, that's how we access the timeline. So I'll try to get there using Sverchok Nodes. So scenes and then timeline markers. Okay. Set properties. Actually not set properties, it's a object set MK2 and plug in the scene. And we want to get to the timeline markers. This guy should give us what we need. So BPY data scenes timeline markers. But look at this, timeline markers actually have a bunch of data items. So in order to get there, either we use like a like index number, I think that will work. Or if you want to get all of them, we just use a timeline markers and this this thing colon, and now we get all the timeline markers. So let me quickly check. So we have timeline markers, we can observe the name and we can observe the frame if I'm not wrong, and we can also observe the camera. So those are three informations we can quickly list it. So we grab the timeline markers, and now the next thing we want to do to look at the name, the frame number. Wait. And the camera. Hopefully this works. So we have the objects, and let me quickly check one first. So object timeline markers, actually out values should go there. Yeah, I think there you go. That's the whole thing. So basically we grab the scene name, we grab the scene data, and then we go inside and find the timeline markers data blocks. And then for each timeline markers, you see here, I'm kind of observing the name of the timeline markers, and then we kind of also observing the frame where the marker is being placed, and then also the camera that's kind of bound to the markers. So everything is listed there. So that's pretty important. First of all, okay, so now that we have all this data, we can do a lot of things. We can export it out if you like, as CSV, for example. If we use text out and use CSV, we can really dump all this data. So this one, and this one, we can dump it into a text if we have a text. I'll quickly create a text object here. And then dump all the information there. Okay, bless you. And we have the name, so we have the name, and then we have the frame number. Maybe it's better to have a frame number before the name. So, and update it, just dump it. There you go, that's the frame number, and then the name, and then the camera that's bound. Sometimes you get nothing, so you have none. You have none here. So whenever we make changes, we can actually change all the name and frame directly from Sverchok, but we don't need to do that now. It's you can try to do that. For example, if I change this this marker's name, Control M to Suzanne, this thing will update. Okay, hello world, Suzanne. Okay, that's if you want to export out the text. So that's gonna be important later, but for now we don't need to worry about that. What we need to worry maybe is just we want to use the frame number, and whenever there is a marker, we want to trigger something using Sverchok, and that's actually kind of simple. We can use a logic, if I'm not wrong, logic, and then equal. So we can, for example, use a frame number. Actually, don't use frame number. We just pipe in all these numbers in there, and then let's see if the marker, we have markers on frame 21. So if something match number 21, just give a result. I'll quickly show you. So it's true. We get true there. Another marker is we have markers on frame 46. So I believe we have typed in this 46. So we get, it says true because we have markers on frame 46. So that's actually very, very important for what we are doing. I will have frame number, and I will use float to integer. So now we are like, if I run this, you will see that the list will change. Whenever there is a marker, this thing will kind of like trigger something. You see? There you go. Another one. So it will give like a true whenever there is a markers. So that's useful information. And we can use that kind of like a triggering action to do the whatever we need to do. For example, we want to make Suzanne, maybe Suzanne change scale whenever there is a marker, so we can do that. First of all, we want to reduce this true, and we want to reduce this list into a single value. There's actually Python formula. It's called any. Is there any true in the list? If there's a true, this any function will give you output of true. So that's actually kind of important. I will try to do this. I think this should work. It gives an error because currently this is like a bunch of lists. We probably need to use list delete levels and delete. Probably list delete is not what I need. Maybe list join or something. Boolean object is not iterable. Well, I probably need to use to check my setup here. This is of course a little bit more complicated because I have all these things that trigger a sound. But we need to see here. Okay, list delete level. Okay, list join mix level 4, and then plug into any, and then the output list delete level. Yeah, this thing, it's harder to explain than to actually use it. List join all these lists of booleans level 4, and then mix it, and then plug the data into any, and the output list delete level 1, and we should get false. We're gonna get true whenever there is a marker. Okay, so yeah, that's the only thing we need to control Suzanne, for example, or to control anything that you like. In this case, I will just use Suzanne, and I will I can make a Suzanne color. I'll try like Suzanne color, changing Suzanne color based on the markers. Okay, whenever there's a marker, change color. Okay, this should work. So I will grab Suzanne real quick, objects in light, and I'm gonna get Suzanne, and Suzanne, actually I should use objects in MK3, get Suzanne, and object, use object set color, plug in this object, and I will use a switch node, and I will kind of pipe in value. I'll use a color in. So we're gonna use, we end up using a lot of more nodes that I was planning to, but that's okay. So I'll give for a red color and then blue color. So we have red and blue plug into this guy, and the state goes in there. And if everything works, should contain 4 items, not 3. Okay, this should use alpha. There you go. So now we have Suzanne, and if the timeline is running, and then whenever there is a marker, Suzanne will change color. And I'll display it using the timeline so it's clear. I was planning to use sound and stuff, but I think that's gonna be, that can be for the next. But you see, whenever there's a marker, Suzanne changed color to red, even though it's like only for one frame. And everything runs in real time. But like I said, it doesn't need to run in real time as long as you know where the marker is and where the cue for things to happen. And then you kind of sync everything that way. And the nice thing about this is you can just change it, change the position of the marker any time you like. And if I'm not wrong, if I switch to the 3D, to the camera, view through the active camera, we can also sync to the camera. Okay, so yeah, that's pretty much it. It's a little bit, it might be a little bit complicated. Let me know in the comments below if you have any feedback, suggestion, or something you want to ask. So basically, it's a triggering of action based on the markers. That's actually what I want to explain using this live noding video. And I'm doing that using just nodes in Sverchok. So it's trigger, marker. And I think markers and timelines are the simplest thing that I could show you using Blender. Like all this action triggering thing can be more complicated, but I think this is pretty interesting. And then in fact, if you are curious, each of the marker names can be like a commands that to trigger something, you know what I mean? So if you have like a commands that says, okay, open the door, or like turn on the light, you can actually turn on the light in the room using Blender and Sverchok. You know, if you like to do that, change the color of the room, for example, or triggering Siri if you have iPhone. But anyway, that's for the future live noding ideas. Hopefully you like this, and I'll see you in the next video. Thank you.